Coaching Jim, what a great run he's had. He's won two straight ECHL championships, and he won last year in the RHI with Anaheim, so he's going for his fourth title in 2 years.
A lot of credit has to go to the head coach. When you talk about the Buffalo team, a lot of people mention a very close team. That starts at the head coach. He sets that team attitude right at the beginning of the season, and obviously it's carried over here into the playoffs.
Minnesota dumps it in, played behind the net by Buffalo's Chris Bergeron in the 24. Now Whalen with a quick shot from the side.
Tyrone Bergeron, Corb O'Neill.
And in the corner, it's played by Tom Nemeth. Nemeth's got 9 points so far. Buffalo coming in, Beccarelli in front, trying to get it teed up. He couldn't really get it on his stick. And he went over the net with a chopping puck. Now in front, another chance. This time Nemeth on the skewer side. Nicely by Bill Pye. We've seen Bill, despite all the accolades for the offense from Minnesota, he kind of gets, I don't know, shuffle the sides there. Don't forget to put a headline in his name as well.
Bill Pye does the job with the timing. The key saves at the right time. Take a look at Larry Olam skating off to the bench. He's looking for a rest here. Buffalo coming back with some pretty good offense, a two-on-one, and Beccarelli had the chance, but he just missed out because the puck was bouncing a little too much. And then Bill Pye, the goaltender, came up big with a lot of aggressive play. He's a stand-up guy most of the time, Pye is, but he uses the poke check effectively, and we just saw that example. Aggressive when he needs to be. If not, he just stands up, plays the angles.
Led the league and wins with 17 second in minutes played and second in saves. Guess who was number one? Right, the guy at the other end, Nick Bertuzzi, who has played all but 12 minutes in the playoffs so far. Here's David Chute coming down. Drops it back to Tim Hannes in front on the backhand, knocked down. Crumbles into the goaltender, knocked Bertuzzi down. And again, we've seen this several times this year. It's tough situation for the goaltender, Jim, who are very often like a stop sign for these players.
The puck is passed off there, and it looks like the player was kind of directed into the goal. He didn't have much room to move. It was Tim Hannes, but Bertuzzi doesn't really agree with that play. He wants the offensive man to get out of the way. A good attack that time, 3-on-2 for Minnesota. There's a look at Hannes. He has everything in order, gets the elbow pad back on, gets his gloves back on. He wants to put the puck in the net, not himself.
Well, I think Tim never saw the red light there. He had his foot on the accelerator and went right through it. Buffalo in the black works it right back. Rick Corvo with a slap shot. Bad save. Pye rebound shot wide of the net by Jason Cerrone. As he had a great chance. So far, Buffalo has had the better chances. Hanson back the other way. Nice move around Corvo. Shot stopped, though, neatly by Bertuzzi, who keeps it going and allows Buffalo to outlet, maybe get an offensive chance. Cerrone down the wing. Slaps one wide. All the way back to the point. Hicks back in front for Hendry. Number 14, John Hendry. Now the corner, Jay Neal, an all-star, goes after it. David Chute plays it up ahead and near the red line. Comes right back in by Mark Major. What a big task tonight for Buffalo, Jim. Can't beat up to win not only game two, to win this game. They'll force a mini game. We'll have that right after this, a 12-minute game to decide the series.
What makes it difficult for Buffalo is that they have to play aggressive. They have to try and take the body. At the same time, you can't run at Minnesota. They're too skilled. They'll skate right around you.
Hendry, quick one-timing shot by Majors, stopped in front. Buffalo has a reputation of being a defensive club. Don't get fooled. They have some potent offense as well. 10 guys score 10 goals or more. That is as many as Minnesota had. 10 double-digit scorers.
Reed Larson going off a lot of experience. There's an NHL veteran, Dennis Marouk. He had 50, 60 goal seasons in the National Hockey League. The way he styled his team, he talked to the players coming into the camp. Attitude on the players was score, score, score. So Marouk said, hey, I'm going to play to their strengths. I'm just going to make that style of team. So he has not held them back at all. He just wants them to look for offense.
Stick handle. Instead of moving your feet. Just keep moving your feet to me. Just keep moving your feet, all right? That's all right.
How many coaches have you heard say shoot the puck? Giveaway opportunity here for Koshaw coming in. Thank you, partner. That's Nemeth coming in. It's stopped by Pye. Tom Nemeth, a defenseman who is known to be around that net. He was the leading scorer among defensemen in the ECHL last year, over 90 points. Larry Olin comes in. Another defenseman who can score. Stopped by Bertuzzi. How much fun it must be, Jim, for the defenseman. Even the goaltenders to get on the scoring sheet. Beccarelli comes in. I know the locker before the game, Nick Bertuzzi, who's got 3 points in the playoffs, has more points than about three Stampede guys, and he made sure each one knew them. Thrown by Jay Moore. Throws it across the surface quickly. But Leyland could not get to it. And Buffalo will bring it down. John Gleason, number 23, dumped hard. Good check by Jay Moore. Rammed around the net. Minnesota coming out, 8:22 to go in the first quarter. Craig Minervini, Jim Fox, glad you joined us again. Playoff coverage. Just one game to go on our coverage after this one. The winner moves on to the championship final. Anaheim and Portland will begin their series tonight. And the winner will face the winner out here. And we'll have it for you. We'll tell you about that later on as Leyland throws it around. We get the whistle with an even 8 minutes to go in the first quarter. And so far, nothing on the board from the Target Center. In game one, Minnesota winning in a shootout, 8-7. Tim Honnes had the game winner. John Hansen had four goals. The power plays, a blast, 3-for-8, the best one in the league this year at 60%. Stampede 2-for-7, Beccarelli with five goals. But Beccarelli tied it, Jim, with 18 seconds to go. And then Buffalo scored a goal at the buzzer. The players celebrated for 2 seconds. The referees waved it off.
And I think everyone agrees that once you go into a shootout situation, the advantage goes directly to Minnesota. They have the types of players, the good, skilled, quick hands that can be effective on those breakaways.
We talked about the matchup in the open. That is not a good matchup for Buffalo. Not only is Minnesota so skilled, but Buffalo now 2-5 this year in shootouts. Bergeron across the surface, quick shot wide of the net by Tom Nemeth. Now Bergeron again back to the point. One-timer hit the post. Big shot from the all-star Jay Neal, number 44. Bergeron dumps it behind the net. Played by Jason Cerrone now, number 34. Jason dumps toward the net. John Hansen picks it off. John tied for the playoff lead with Jerry St. Cyr of Portland. 19 points. Shoot. Wheeling in. Throws it over to Hannes. And Jim, this kind of reminds me of the Atlanta-Minnesota start that we saw a couple of weeks ago in the first-round playoffs, where the Arctic Blast could not get it going offensively. You can see how Buffalo's D is stymieing Minnesota here. Shoot across the surface. Over to Skarda coming in, wide of the net. This is a really an offensive machine so far this year. And Buffalo's bothering them. Henry was tripped, no penalty call. Henry circles back against the check of Jim Howe. And Henry comes in one-on-one. Henry now, quick wrist shot, good pad save by Pye. Again, Billy Pye, as sharp as attack. Reed Larson, longtime NHLer, known for his big shot. Knocked off the wheels. Not shooting quite as hard here. Nice pass in front though, the backhand, it's Andringa dumped out, penalty upcoming against Buffalo. And Minnesota will go on the power play as Reed Larson set it up. Mark Major will head out for 2 minutes.
There wasn't much aggressive play onto the puck. And we'll see the nice little backhand pass there by Reed Larson. Protection, get the leg out by Andringa, and Mark Major is forced to take him down by just chopping right through his legs. So good pass and good prop protection. Another look, it's kind of a delayed reaction play, and Andringa goes down, so Minnesota will get the first chance on the power play. Then Buffalo clears the front of the net. Great job there by Buffalo. And actually, Craig, I think Buffalo did a good job away from the puck, the one-on-one coverages, but too much control by Minnesota. They had too much time. Finally, Larson had time to make that good pass.
Buffalo wants to keep Minnesota from getting the shots in front of the net, keep them to the perimeter, and force the shooter a lot. They're not going to wait and let them wheel and pass. Here's John Young, 11. Larry Olim at the point. A diamond formation intercepted nicely in front of the net. And dumped down by Beccarelli.
We just saw one of the keys for Buffalo on the penalty kill. They want to take away the seams, the cross passes. What Buffalo is going to do is probably give this man right here, the guy at the top of the diamond, the shot.
Quickly shot from the other side. Two stops by Bertuzzi. A tough one in front. As you hear Denny Marouk saying, shoot up high on the goaltender.
You're ready, Blue.
Young sent it down to Leyland. Back to the point, as Jim mentioned, they were looking for Larry Olin. They could not find him. Larry, the second highest scoring defenseman in the league, set a record with 9 points against Pittsburgh, that 14-11 win in game two of that series. Olin, there's the big shot with the puck on its edge. Locked in front by Alex Hicks. Now back out, Jay Moore sets up Young. Nice defensive stop by Buffalo's Jay Neely. Gets
Beccarelli, the leading scorer. Shot, quick save, rebound is put aside.
By Bilpai, 45 seconds in the Buffalo penalty. Good scoring opportunities on both ends. Wayland back to Jay Moore. Wheels around Hicks. Still wheeling. Hooked nicely from behind by Alex Hicks, the captain, who throws his weight. Now we're looking for Olam again. And again, the seam cut off by Beccarelli. Up to Alex Hicks, comes in one-on-one against Jay Moore. Around Moore, nicely, he's in. Going, shooting, scores! What a goal by Alex Hicks. That's one for the highlight film. A defensive play leading to the offensive chance, and Hicks, a defenseman, showing some offensive moves.
It doesn't get any better than that move by Hicks, but it was a smart play, good defense by Buffalo. Beccarelli with the outlet pass. Now watch the dipsy doodle coming, pull and drag. And right there, Moore tries to get back, but from the first move, he was one step behind, one half step. Then watch the patience of Hicks right here. Goes to the forehand, waits for Pye to go down, then he goes way up into the top of the net. Great job by Alex Hicks. They didn't have Hicks last night. He was out with a suspension, but he's back tonight. Shorthanded goal makes his presence felt.
15 seconds of the power play. Skarda throws it across the surface to Hannes. Buffalo led the league in shorthanded goals this year with 19. And they add another one. They're second in the playoffs. Hannes throwing it across. You'll notice they try to set up the one-timer with a quick pass. We're even Steven again. 4-on-4. Quick shot. Stopped by Bertuzzi. Throws into the corner play by David Chu, number 20. Now, Buffalo capturing again. John Henry dumps out to the center line. Mark Major plays it there. Honest over there. Skarda throws him in hard into the glass. And that's going to be a penalty. Interestingly enough, though, is the referee away from the play that made the call. The ref near the center line let it go. So a power play opportunity upcoming for the Stampede, who have already scored. Short-handed, and they lead early in the first.
First penalty against Minnesota. Randy Skarda goes off. We thought it was going to be physical. Buffalo usually leads in hitting. We're going to regular speed here. Listen to this hit. And that was Randy Skarda all the way. They called it boarding. I think the reason, because Skarda hit the player directly from behind, right square in the back, hard against the boards. First chance on the power play for Buffalo.
All right, so Buffalo's on the power play. What a check on Hicks. And let's see how they work this diamond as well. Corvo is at the top of the diamond. He shoots it, and Pye makes the stop and hangs on. With 3 minutes and 31 seconds to go here in the first quarter, and a buck 49 on the penalty. Here's the playoff format. 16 teams started it all off in about the middle of August. Top four from each division made the playoffs. A two-game series, one in each city. A 12-minute mini-game, which we could see tonight if Buffalo wins game two. Otherwise, we're all done. Also, of course, the home surface advantage going to the team with a better record. And in this situation, Minnesota has the home surface. However, if Buffalo should win the game, then they'll have the home surface for the final. Quick shot, Corvo stop, rebound in front, and Pye was able to grab it. Hang on, he's talking to Grant Saunier, Jim, the head coach of Anaheim, with an interesting viewpoint. If his team gets to the final, they only have to travel one time to play in the championship. Minnesota or Buffalo, rather, would have to go out there and then come back.
Last shot here on the power play by Buffalo. The screen is set up by Cerrone in front. Look at Billy Pye fight for that loose puck. He gave up the rebound, but he did a great job keeping the puck right at his feet. The rebound didn't get away from him, and that's extra important on the power play. When you're killing the penalty one man down, that man, the extra man, usually gets a good chance on the rebound. Not that time.
Minute 27 on the penalty. Quick shot from the right side. Save, rebound, and they score! Yes, it was put in by Jason Cerrone, number 34. It just got across the line. And Buffalo, how many chances have they had already in this game where they've been pouncing on rebounds, and Pye has stopped everyone. This time he could not stop Cerrone.
Play before this, the rebound was controlled by Pye. It was a simple shot, not really a hard shot, from the off wing, and Cerrone's in front to bat in the rebound. Cerrone was playing in front all the way, looking for screens or rebounds. Well, they got the rebound, just a chip shot on the backhand. Simple setup there by Buffalo on the power play. They went to the diamond, they had one man in front, that's all they wanted. And Chris McSorley very happy with what happened here. 2-0 Buffalo.
Sergio will get one of the assists.
Single assist number
2:55 remaining. Here in the second quarter, first quarter, rather, tough start for Minnesota here. Young in the corner. Young coming out. Looks to set up something. where the point shot from Whalen is stopped. Minnesota just looks a step slower than they normally are tonight. Ahead of the play, Jay Neal waits for it. Ahead of the D as well. Centering it. He's dumped aside by Corey Leyland nicely. Corey got the puck caught up in his uniform. And we get the whistle with 2:27 to go. There's Corey Leyland. He was not sure about playing in the RHI this year, but he's a local guy from St. Cloud, Minnesota. Went to St. Cloud Apollo High School, and he said one of the big things for him was to play here in front of the home crowd. The Arctic Blast, as you look at Dennis Baruch, almost all of the players except for two, Andringa and Pai, are from Minnesota. So this is really a locally grown team, and how well they have played. I think guys from Minnesota are better in chilly sports, Jim, rather than summer sports. 2:20 to go. Buffalo leading 2-0 early going. Dave Shute coming down. Minnesota averaged 12 goals a game during the regular campaign. Another defensive stop for Buffalo. It's Lenny Sosia comes in and crank one right off the side of that post again. As we approach the 2-minute mark, first quarter.
Turnover by Minnesota right at the center line. The forwards getting a little too far ahead. That's what happens when Minnesota gets in trouble. There's no outlet pass for the defense. That causes turnovers.
Skarner with it, throws it out. A lot of teams seem to play better, Jim, with their backs to the walls. And we saw that with Atlanta against Minnesota. We may be seeing that from Buffalo. They cannot lose the first game. Of course, Minnesota wants to win it, but you think there's anything to that? That they come out here, they already won game one. And they look a little short on the desire end right now.
Well, you think you have things in control. I think you get a false sense of security every time you come back home, but you have to play the same game.
Socio with a shot. Good stick save by Bill Pye. He's been tested. Socio again behind the net. Throws it over to Vecchiarelli. Bumped by Scarta. John gets it back to the point. Nemeth throws it there on the stick of Socio. Whistle behind the play. And I believe he's saying there was an offside pass, but it started from the Buffalo zone. Well, stay with the Deuce after tonight's game for more of Anything Goes with Jim Rome and Talk 2. Tonight's guest will be Carmen Policy, president of the San Francisco 49ers, and Meldrick Taylor, who talk of his September 17th rematch against Julio Cesar Chavez. Don't miss it. Talk 2 live tonight at 10:30 after the game.
There's Chris McSorley, his team in control. Actually, it's kind of funny. They scored a shorthanded goal already. McSorley told me before the game his team would be less aggressive on the penalty kill than they were in the regular season.
Buffalo, another chance in front. Wide of the net on a shot attempt by Dave LeMay.
Well, they're going to be less aggressive on the penalty kill, but it's not going to stop them even strength. But they did get that shorthanded goal. Buffalo really in control here in the first quarter.
We are even strength here with 40 seconds remaining in the first quarter. Reed Larson dumped down and a penalty upcoming. Going to be a holding penalty. And that is not the type of penalty that Buffalo wants to take. Dave LeMay, number 37, will go to the box.
And it's the part of the game, the time of the game. Take a look at it. Reed Larson just looking for the loose puck. And LeMay just rides his back. Larson goes down. Holding will be the call on Dave LeMay. But Buffalo had it in control. The momentum was being controlled by Buffalo.
Shouldn't fucking have it. Come on, hold that rebound.
And Denny Maruk hopes his team can get the momentum back here with a power play opportunity. Once again, Buffalo will try to take away the seam pass, the cross pass. And Minnesota might be forced in taking a long shot. But if they give you that long shot, you have to take it, then go for the rebound.
Jim Fox will be heading down to the benches. He's been getting in good shape. I saw him on the exercise bike this morning. You're ready to make that big move down there. And we'll hear from both of the coaches and the players during the game. Second and fourth quarter as usual. So Minnesota with that heralded offensive attack, especially in the power play, they get their chance here with 20 seconds to go in the quarter. John Young, leading scorer in the league. Back to the point. Larry Olin setting up Young for the shot. Screen shot blocked in front. May have hit his own man. He had nothing to shoot at. It hit the back foot of Corey Leyland. Vecchiarelli out with 7 seconds to go. Buffalo with a shorthanded goal already in the first quarter. Dominating play as Young shoots at the buzzer, and that'll do it.
Ladies and gentlemen, if you're interested,
the Stampede have won quarter number one. Still three more to go, though, as they hope to move on tonight to the championship finals. After one, Buffalo leading 2-0. We'll be right back. Good to have you back with us on the Deuce, live tonight as Buffalo leads Minnesota 2-0 after one quarter of play. Craig Bitterveni upstairs, Jim Fox working the benches now for the second quarter. First quarter action, there's the shots on goal, 16-7 for Buffalo. The scoring chances, 10-4 Buffalo. Faceoffs are even, and Buffalo scoring on the power play. So Minnesota starts it off here. The clock has not moved yet. 1:20 to go on the power play chance. A late start on the clock for Minnesota. Young in front of that. Shot stopped by Bertuzzi. The penalty time is still not started. And I'll tell you something. Buffalo is going to have about 5 seconds tacked onto that penalty. Minnesota again sets it up. 0-for-1 in the power play. They gave up a shorthanded goal. Here's Young, the leading scorer, number 11. Goes to Larry Olin. They've got some huge scores out there. Jay Moore is back, lost his edge, and Beccarelli nearly broke out. Back the other way, Leland. Quick wrister, flutters wide of the net. Now Young behind the net for Minnesota. Back to Jay Moore. Cross the surface to Larry Olin. Number 17 for Minnesota. Larry out of War Road, Minnesota. 25 years of age, got a big crank, shooting for the tip in front, and Moore tips it wide. Now Leland. Corey over to Young, trying to better his shot, skitters off the stick, Beccarelli may break out of here. He's got the edge on Olin, he comes in, breaks around, a backhand score! Another shorthanded goal for Buffalo, as John Beccarelli shows very clearly why, if you have the head of steam in this game, you're going to get past the guy who's standing still.
Well, McSorley, the head coach of Buffalo, said his team would not be aggressive penalty killing. Well, he was lying, because this is a second shorthanded goal by Buffalo, and Beccarelli, once he got the puck, he went all the way. He was thinking offense all the way, and he just skated by Olam right there. Bill Pye went aggressively with a poke check, but Beccarelli was ready for it, very patient to the back end, had a wide open net.
So Beccarelli, who comes off a 5-goal game against Minnesota, it's number 9 in the playoffs. And how about this? Minnesota has not scored in the power play, and they've given up 2 short-handed goals. In front shot! How'd that one miss? It went right through the net. The side of the net, I should say. David Schut had a wide-open cage, and he missed it somehow. Man, how'd he miss that one, Jim?
Well, Minnesota gets it. You see the nice cross pass. He has everyone going the wrong way, and he shoots it back through the crease. Oh. So it's not a situation where he wasn't bearing down, actually kind of bear down a little too much. I think that happens sometimes when you think you're going to get hit, and you put a little extra on the puck, you're a little stronger on the puck to try and counteract that hit. And he shot it wide. Now the officials at the penalty box discussing something. Minnesota was up here on the bench yelling about having too many men on the ice. Perhaps they're talking about that now.
Here's David Schut, who's wondering how he missed it. John Beccarelli now leading the way with 21 points. Andy Rimshaw of Portland, 19 points, as the Rage try to battle Anaheim to get to the championship series. Hansen and Olin, and then Brian Downey with 17 points. Jim, I did mention that they were a little late in the penalty time. Is that what the argument's about?
Down here with the head coach, Chris McSorley of the Buffalo Stampede. Chris, you told me before the game your team wasn't going to be too aggressive killing penalties. When the chance is there, they're going for the net.
Well, I'll save confession for tomorrow here, Jimmy. I didn't anticipate scoring shorthanded goals against a team that controls the puck as well as Minnesota, but we had a few breaks. They made a few costly turnovers. We went down and were able to jump on their net pretty quickly.
Don't want to look back to last night's game, but last night you had a 2-goal lead, then it got away from you. What can you do to try and counteract that tonight?
All we got to do is stay out of the box, play with some intelligence, keep picking up the wings, slowing things down through the neutral zone. I guarantee you the skill we have on defense is going to be the difference in tonight's game.
Do we know what's going on here with officials right now talking about? I think it's the game clock. Something went wrong?
No, somebody over there was caught cheating playing bridge over there, so I know the referee's over there to dock some points, so hopefully we can do that right away.
You know who's winning?
Right now, referees too. Buffalo none right now.
If they're
now
playing bridge, I think the referees have the dummy hand, is that what we call them?
Yeah, they got the authority in this one.
Okay, thanks, Chris.
Thank you.
All right, 10-19 to go here in the second quarter, and Buffalo leading 3-0. Minnesota had the number one power play in the league this year, 65%.
We did not have five guys, Luke. I had a hold of my guy's jersey.
There's no fucking way you're going to do this. There's no fucking way you're going to do this.
Talking about too many.
What happened they're talking about, Craig, is a situation where the officials in the penalty box allowed Buffalo's penalized player to come onto the floor early. Now, that's a question of whether the off-floor officials made the mistake. And we'll try to see him count. There's Buffalo. You see they have five players. There's no doubt there's two by the bench, and both of those players are coming on. The other three are right in the middle of the floor. But the issue from Buffalo's point is that the off-floor official, the official in the penalty box, allowed the penalized player to come back a little early. And they got caught in a situation, but you saw it clearly there. Two men coming on the floor with three men already out there. Remember, in roller hockey, it's four skaters and one goaltender. Now Minnesota gets a chance again on the power play.
Maybe they thought it was ice hockey again there for a moment. It is just about that time of the year. They have five skaters out there again. I'll tell you one thing, the clock definitely did start late, but Buffalo should not complain. They've already scored two short-handed goals as they go for a third. Alex Hicks, who had one of them, and Minnesota 0 for 2 on the power play, and they have given up two, which is really disgraceful for them in this kind of a meaningful game. Hannes, quick shot wide of the net, comes all the way around it. John Hansen, Hansen, Skarda, Hannes, and Shooter out there. Shot, flicks over the cage, and again, Beccarelli will get a chance to get it out. And Buffalo's thinking, oh, here, he's got a little edge on Skarda. Quick shot, score! Backhanded shot by Beccarelli, and Buffalo has three short-handed goals. And they lead it 4-0.
John Beccarelli has taken charge of this game. Chris McSorley, his head coach, says he's the best player in the league. Well, he's showing why right now. Not really taking chances, I don't think, because when he's intercepting the puck on the penalty kill, we'll take a look at it at regular speed. Look at him. Once he gets control, he knows what he has in mind, and that's take the puck to the net. He slides a backhand to the far side. You saw regular speed again. Bill Pye, the goaltender, got himself caught just hanging on the near post. And on the rollers, you can't shuffle as quick. Buffalo leads 4-0.
Jim, Minnesota is not doing a good job. Beccarelli should not have even been able to get a shot on goal there. But he got the edge and got another great chance. He's going to have a chance at a hat trick, a natural hat trick. He comes in a pie. Another nice move. And this time, Pye gets the stick on it. And did he ever? He lost the stick. It skittered away about 20 feet.
And the Buffalo players are yelling that he threw his stick. Beccarelli looking for that third shorthander.
He may think that's the only way he can stop him now. Buffalo with three shorthanded goals in the first 14 minutes of this game. Moore scores to the point. Young was in the crease. They're going to wave the goal off. No goal. No goal. John Young was clearly in the crease, and the referee is waving off the goal.
And the referee is emphatic. He had no time to make a decision at all. He waved it off. He had the washout signal going and more things going against the Arctic Blast, setting it up. Watch for the crease. Young is there. He's in the crease. He was not pushed. He was coming out from behind. Now, there was no contact with the goaltender, but that does not matter. And the faceoff is coming out into the neutral zone. And Dennis Marouk pointing up to the clock right now. I think some more time. Number 11 coming out from the bottom left of your screen. 1 foot, 2 feet in the crease. And the goaltender is not necessarily hit. But you can see Petrucci there, he has to worry. He feels that pressure there, and the goaltender did not move over. He couldn't because he felt the traffic. The goal is taken away. Still 31 seconds remaining on this power play for Minnesota.
Looked like it may have, I don't know, Jim, from this angle, tough to see, but it may have even grazed off the back of John Young, maybe hit the back of his pants. He was clearly in the crease. It's kind of a tough call. He may not have had anything to do with it. But that is the rule. You cannot be in the crease unless you're pushed in there. Going back out to the point. So Skarda has it. Minnesota has given up three shorthanded. One power play. Now they have one taken away. 11 seconds still in the power play as Skarda works it in. Nightmarish start. One hit the post this time. And Minnesota can't get any breaks. 8:20 to go in the second quarter. A very lively start. Jim Hannes coming down. He shoots. Big pad stop by Petrucci. Stand-up save there. And Jay Neal works it out. We are 4-on-4 again. David Schutz pass picked off by Buffalo. That's Chris Bergeron. Dumps it back, quick shot, Cerrone. A bad stop by Ty. He gets the sarcastic response from the crowd here. Now stolen by Bergeron. He comes in on a breakaway. Bergeron deking, holding, shooting. Stop by Ty. He stayed with his man that time. And Buffalo getting way too many terrific scoring chances here against Minnesota. The faces are not smiling at the target center. Nice hat, too. 7:44 to go.
We're down on the bench with Minnesota. Jay Moore, the captain. Jay, obviously a bad position. Four goals down. What's the plan?
Well, at this point, it isn't too good right now, Jim. We're, you know, we got down a little bit at the first period here. We just got to fight back and try to get a few goals. During the course of the year, we had the most goals in all of roller hockey, so we just got to concentrate on that and try to put some points on the board here.
You got to talk about that power play. Shorthanded goals are killing you. Any big mistakes there?
I think during the course of the year, we were just, you know, we had a lot of success on our power play. I think we're using that to our advantage, and I think we're a little bit too comfortable with it. You know, and Buffalo's pretty good shorthanded, and we should have been aware of that. But I think we have enough time here to come back.
All right, good luck the rest of the way.
Well, no question about that, this big scoring team. But Hicks trying to make it 5-0. Now, shot score was knocked in on the rebound. I'm not sure if it was Hicks who got the stick to it. He got the first shot off, but Buffalo pouncing on the rebound makes it 5-0. And if it keeps going like this, Minnesota will run out of time in a hurry.
All kinds of traffic in front. LeMay was there, Big Mark Major was there, and Hicks was there. Look at the forecheck by Buffalo. They don't come at you real hard, but they play smart positionally. The first chance is stopped by Pye, and turning around was LeMay. Now, you're going to have to look at this one. If we had another chance, maybe. There looked like to me this time Buffalo had someone in the crease. It was not called this time. Take a look at it. Not the first chance by Hicks. Just off to the right is Big Mark Major, I believe. And he's standing right beside the goaltender. But this one counts. 5-0 Buffalo.
Jim Bim, Bill Pye should sue for lack of defense here. I mean, he's just been by himself. Too many great chances for Buffalo. And Pye has made several stops in the game. He might falter for the Beccarelli shorthanded goal, but he has just been defenseless back there with Minnesota.
Craig, I think the one big mistake that Minnesota makes, their last man, the guy carrying the puck up the floor, he's not making a safe play. He's making a risky play, turnover, and right back on the goal.
Excellent point. Leyland comes in trying to work around Nemeth. Penalty upcoming on Buffalo, and Minnesota will get a power play, and they might decline it here, Jim.
They should. One good thing, Craig, is that Beccarelli is the man who took the penalty, so they don't have to worry about him scoring his third shorthanded goal. But you're right, nothing has been going right for Minnesota. All of their big things, their big assets, have been going wrong. But they're going to go back here on the power play. Denny Marouk, I don't think he has many answers right now. He just has to get his team to get that one goal just to break the floor. Or usually you say break the ice.
That's right. Denny might put the wheels on at the half. 878 points, 850 NHL games over a 14-year career. There's John Beccarelli. John, not only a good scorer, he likes to work with old cars in his spare time. By the way, if you know anybody who wants to sell a Corvette in about 64, 65, give John a call. He's been looking for one. He just dumped his 77 Corvette. Right now, Minnesota looking like an old beat-up car here that is running out of gas. In front, Patusi makes the stop. Rebound, Jay Moore over there. And Buffalo knocks it over the glass and into the crowd. Off the stick of John Blessman. Big 6'3" defenseman. There's Johnny, likes to golf and bowl and watch Jeopardy. But there's nothing trivial about his game. He's a good one. 6 minutes, 22 seconds remaining. Buffalo leading 5-0. Buffalo lost just one regulation game over the last 14 in the regular season. And a lot of the guys were saying that the loss last night might help them out tonight as you look at their score, because they were so comfy beating all these teams in the RHI. And occasionally that can knock you right down to level again when you lose one. Larry Olin with 6:12 to go. Minnesota being shut out. That's a huge story in and of itself through almost 1.5 quarters now. Olin goes in, gambled again, as Jim was talking about. Neal comes in 2-on-1. Neal has Hicks. Couldn't get it to him this time. Moore made the saving block. And Minnesota's got a 3-on-1 as a result. Leland over to Olin, coming in. Shoots for the top shelf, and he missed it. And you could see he tried to pick it out, as Denny Marouk was encouraging earlier to his team. Bergeron around Leyland, coming in, shooting wide of the net. Minnesota comes back. John Young looks behind him. Now drops to Jay Moore. 5.5 to go in the second. Moore over to Larry Olim. Another 40 seconds of the power play. Olim waiting for the shot. He'll tee this one up. Didn't get good wood to it. Bothered. He took the puck near his skates. Olim set up. Wrist shot. Good stop by Bertuzzi. He hangs on. Nick making a big save there with 30 seconds to go on the penalty.
The movement there by Minnesota wasn't too bad. They moved the puck around finally, but got to do a better job of getting in that scoring area, getting into the middle. Olin with a shot. Bertuzzi has it all the way. He sees it all the way. There was not any traffic set up in front. Credit the big Buffalo defenders for that. Goals against average in the playoffs. Hey, no surprise. Right at the top, Nick Bertuzzi. Just over 6 goals a game. Rob Laurie of Anaheim, you saw the rest of them. Goaltending is important at any time, but obviously it's more important in the playoffs. And of course, Bill Pye, the guy that doesn't get much credit because of all the offense from Minnesota, he was 4th on that list. Tonight though, down by 5 goals.
22 seconds power play, shooting wide of the net. And the goal judge probably can't believe he hasn't gotten to work yet with Minnesota shooting at the net. Actually did put it on once, but the goal was waved off. Big shot, Hannes hit the post. And you can hear that one. 4:50 to go. Hannes throwing it into the corner. David Shute was over there. Buffalo could not clear. It's now full strength. Quick shot from the point. Off the stick of Scarta. Wide of net. In front. Backhand chance. Saved by Bertuzzi on Hansen. Another good stop. 3-on-1 possible here. Beccarelli coming out. He has Socia behind him. Drops it back. Over the other side. Saved by Pye. And he hangs on. Alex Hicks looking for his second goal of the game with 4:25 remaining. It has been all Buffalo in the Twin Cities. 4:25 to go.
Well, now we're on the Buffalo bench with Chris Bergeron. Chris, tell me the situation. Did you ever expect to be up by 5 goals, 5-0 against Minnesota?
I don't think we expected to be up 5-0. I just think that as a group, we wanted to come out and play hard. We felt we played, you know, adequate last night in Buffalo. We had to come out hard tonight and establish ourselves, establish our finishing our checks and things like that. And we've been lucky enough to get a couple of shorthanded goals by some great efforts by Beccarelli and Hicks. And Bertuzzi's playing big. So we just hope to continue this the way it's going this first half.
4 minutes, 12 seconds remaining. Quick shot from the point by Andringas. Steered aside by Bertuzzi again. So often the defense will set up an offensive maneuver. And it does here. Hendry comes in the backhand. Pye makes the stop and kicks the net off the line. And we get the whistle with an even 4 minutes remaining in the second quarter.
You can see the confidence in Buffalo. Now they're trying those one-on-one moves. Hendry this time, it starts deep in his zone. The puck comes in the middle. Now watch Hendry. Again, one thing on his mind, take the puck to the goal. Nice little move to the backhand. He didn't get much on the shot. By that time, he was on a bad angle. But confidence building here with Buffalo. They're not necessarily known for that big offense. They're not known for the one-on-one moves, but they're doing everything here tonight.
John Hendry from Toronto, Ontario. Detroit Red Wings draft pick. Big check there on Jay Moore. Thrown off the fine play by LeMay. Hendry was a 12th round pick of the Red Wings back in 1990. Also played in the NCAA champions at Lake Superior State in 92. Leyland comes in, gets around the D, making a shot off, holding, and he's steered aside by LeMay. And Buffalo comes out again. Mark Major, one-on-one, Olim is back. Coming into the play is Hendry, and Major couldn't get it to him. Major again, backhanding it. Played by Hendry. 7 points so far in the playoffs. Also scored on 40% of his shots to lead the team. 6 goals, just 15 shots. 3:12 to go. Second quarter, Buffalo. 2-0 after one, added 3 more here in the second. 3 shorthanded goals, 1 power play goal. Hansen comes in, easy stop for Bertuzzi. Now Cerrone in the corner is bumped and is played by Tom Nemeth. And Buffalo again on the attack. As Bergeron comes in, Bergeron breaks, scores! Chris Bergeron makes it 6-0 Buffalo. And Buffalo played up as a defensive team. Boy, they're pretty crafty in front of that net as well.
Craig, what's happening is Buffalo's getting so much speed up back in their own zone that once they hit the center line, they're at top speed. And no matter what you do as a defenseman, it's very difficult. Oh, you saw right there Bergeron cutting in, but he had a good pick right in front of the goal. Another look at it. He builds up speed. Someone's going to try and slow him down. Now watch the pick in front. That allows Bergeron to cut right in front. One of the defensemen preoccupied with a man away from the play. Confidence, determination, and no wasted time by Buffalo. Out in front by six.
Jim, Minnesota is playing the old Matador defense. They're not hitting anybody, and you cannot let another team in this league skate in untouched and get those kind of chances. Minnesota, not known as a checking team. Well, it's a glaring weakness, obviously, here tonight.
Something better has to be done up the floor. Slow the team down before they get going.
And Dringa throws toward the net. Minnesota has basically relied on their offense to be their defense this year. When you're scoring that many goals, it's a great defense, but they're not scoring. Shot score! There's another goal! Talk about scoring. Lenny Socio makes it 7-0. Buffalo.
They're going in from everywhere right now. This time Socio takes a shot from outside, and Bill Pye, he's going to take a little rest right now. Nothing going Minnesota's way. It starts with a long outlet pass. This is onside in roller hockey. Now the shot comes from the angle. Bill Pye way back in his goal. I think that's just a sign of a goaltender that's a little down. The confidence isn't there. Look at Pye. He's back on his goal line, usually from the angle. Look at this. 2 feet right in his crease. Oh, no doubt. He's back too far, so any shot can beat him. You don't cover much room that way. Bill Pye beat by the bad angle shot.
Nothing Buffalo. If they win this game, we'll play a mini game right after a 10-minute intermission. And we'll have it for you here on the Deuce. Buffalo needs to win this game and the mini game. Minnesota, after winning last night, needs only to win this game here. And right now, that's going to take a major task. But of course, this game, they are not out of it by any means. If this was ice hockey, you could pretty much write it off. 7-0. Halfway through, they wave off the illegal clear, but Minnesota scored 12 goals a game, so if they could do that in the second half, they'll have a 5-goal win. Not that easy. Arctic Blast coming down again. Larry Olin has David shoot down the wing. Shooting, bad stop by Bertuzzi. He did a nice job blocking the net. Here's Alex Hicks. Alex has had a feisty playoff, leads the team with 27 penalty minutes. Hendry coming in, looking the other way, stopped by Pye, and that puck probably looks like an ant coming at him. It's been tough to stop. Well, the Western Conference, here's a preview of the Portland-Anaheim, how they got there. The Rage defeated the Calgary Rags 2-1 in the conference semifinal. Andy Reimscher, 17 playoff points. He is tied with Johnny Hansen of Minnesota for the lead. Anaheim defeating LA 2-0. That exciting game we had last week on ESPN. And the Bullfrogs are the only undefeated team in the playoffs. Jim, I know we haven't got a look at Portland, but do you think Anaheim is going to be tough to beat out west?
Well, Anaheim plays that smart game. They're the defending champions. They don't really flash anything at you, but they're solid in every area. The scoring and tough hitting, they play it tight.
Minnesota does not play it tight. They haven't had to, though, this year. Good check thrown on Randy Scarter. And they're having their problems here tonight on the home surface. Shoots pass, picked off. Buffalo 2-on-1 again. LeMay coming down. LeMay waiting. LeMay, nice move. And Pye was able to just get a piece of the shot. And LeMay had him beat again. Dave LeMay, 20 years of age. Just recently turned 21. Well, CFA Primetime Football is back Thursday at 8 p.m. ESPN will give you the best seat in the house as the 8th-ranked Arizona Wildcats visit the Georgia Tech Yellow Jackets. Arizona coming off a 10-2 record and the Pac-10 co-championship. So there'll be quite a handful for Jamal Cox and the Tech defense. CFA on ESPN after Russell Athletics weekend kickoff show Thursday night live at 8 p.m. Eastern. Here, 32 seconds remain. Second quarter, Buffalo shutting out Minnesota. That would be story enough. They have also put the light on 7 times behind Bill Pye. 3 shorthanded goals and 1 power play goal. Johnny Hansen as Minnesota looks for one. The Tim Connors works around Corvo. Now the puck goes to the stick of Jay Neal with 5 seconds. And Buffalo will dump it down, and that'll do it for the first half. Wow, what a humbling first half for Minnesota. Buffalo whitewashing Bill Pine Company with 7 goals in the first 24 minutes, and they have a substantial lead at the half. Back in a moment from the Target Center. Craig Minervini back at the half at the Target Center. Minnesota shut out at the half. Buffalo leading 7-0. We're going to go down to the locker room in the Stampede. Some smiling faces, I'm sure, but their work isn't over yet. Jim?
Take the spin. Make sure we're coming back, picking these guys up in the middle to the defenseman. Yes, we're going to be all set because that's where our skill lies right here tonight. The opportunities we're giving them are through the turnovers. We eliminate the turnovers. We're going to as long as we can.
All right, Chris, obviously a great period. I don't think anyone would have expected that kind of surge from your team. But at the same time, I don't see you backing down at all. You still go.
With a team that's skilled, you have to make sure you give them a little hate sometimes. And a lot of times you let this team relax a little bit, they're going to go out there and play relaxed. We created opportunities because of the fact we were able to eliminate the outside lanes, keep things congested in the middle, and the skill on defense really came through that period.
The front of the goal, only one chance against. Otherwise, everything else clears out.
Yeah, we want to make sure we let our size prevail in front of the net, and we got a little ugly with the sticks, made the wood, put the wood in the soft spots in their arms, and kept them away from the front of the net. And we give this, give Nick Petusi, our goaltender, for perimeter shots. He's going to go out big for us every time.
All right, Chris, I'm going to try and walk around here and get some words from some of the players. We're over here with Dave LeMay. Dave, again, we've been mentioning with a lot of people that no one expected this type of a situation. Do you have any words of wisdom just how it did happen?
I don't know. I think we just knew we had to win this game to stay in it, and the guys just come out flying.
Anything else you got to keep your mind on? Does your mind automatically right now shift to the 12-minute mini game?
No, not at all. These guys, best offense in the league. They can score goals, you know, whenever they want, pretty much. So we just got to play good D and keep going.
Does that thing may hurt Minnesota because they're so high-powered, they think they can score so many goals, get into this tight situation? Maybe they're not used to it?
I don't know. You know, Nick's playing well. You know, we're keeping shots to the outside. Just got to keep doing that.
All right. Well, thank you very much. We're going to move over here to Lenny Sachios. Lenny, a lot of action in front of that, both ends of the floor, in front of your goal. Nothing happening, but I saw you down in front of Minnesota's goal a couple of times. Tough action down there, too?
Yeah, we're getting our breaks. We're playing defense first. We're blocking shots. Forwards are blocking shots. Everybody's going down, sacrifices, picking up the spare guys in front of the net, and then we're going down on our, you know, and we're putting our chances in the net.
All right, I want to go over here to Mark Major. I know he spends a lot of time in front of the goals at both ends. Could you expect this?
Well, we had a game plan going into tonight, and our coach just said, you know, pick up the wingers wide and stay with them, and it'll open up everything for us. And right now we're up 7-0. But we got to look forward to the next two periods and then look into the overtime, because we can't get many opportunities to come back into this game until it's over and then go into the Minley game and do the same thing there.
All right, Mark, thanks very much. I'm going to try and walk around. Chris Bergeron again. Chris, I talked to you on the bench. All of a sudden you get on the floor, score a goal. Offense, offense, offense. Confidence. You guys aren't taking a back step. Once you get a chance, you're taking it right to the goal.
We knew Minnesota had an offensive team, and we're more known as a more well-rounded team, I think. But we have our offensive guns as well. You know, the Hickses, the Beccarellis, put them up with the best of them. You know, we've got a nice lead right now, but nothing safe with these guys. The Hansons, the Youngs, the Scarters, these guys can put numbers up right quickly. And we don't want to give up an inch. You know, Chris McSorley, our coach, was already, you know, correcting some things. After a 7-0 first half, you don't think there's too much to correct. But, you know, there's always things you can get better at. And we're looking at a 3-period game from now on. We've got the third, fourth quarter. And then we're hoping to go to a 12-minute minigame, and then it's just a shootout, and we think we can play with anybody right now.
Well, it was all Buffalo in the first half. They're looking forward to that 12-minute minigame. Back up to you, Craig.
You are the leading scoring team in the league. Most points, you're shut out through the first half. What in the world could be going on in your locker room? We'll find out. We'll check in with Minnesota when we come back. There are some tough jobs. One of them is going in the losing team's locker room, especially at the half where it's 7-0. Jim, I know it's a difficult situation down there.
Well, we appreciate their input. We're here with Randy Scarter. Randy, I don't think anyone would have expected this. I've been asking Buffalo what's happened. Can you put your finger on it?
No, we just came out flat. That's all there is to it. We weren't ready to play after, you know, the bell rang and we came out flat, and they just completely outskated us, outworked us, and just dominated us. I mean, they got 3 or 4 shorthanded goals. That about says it all right there.
It certainly was a dominating first half by Buffalo. We're over here with John Hansen. John, one of your players mentioned on the bench that perhaps the power play can bring you a little too overconfident at times. You think you can score just about every time. When it's shut down, then the trouble starts. What's your input on that?
Well, it was a breakdown by all four guys out there on the power play. Each time they scored shorthanded, it was, you know, one guy, you know, a guy just beat all four guys and, you know, went down and scored on, you know, a couple breakaways and then one shot. So it's tough right now. We got to come back and see what happens in the second half here.
It's tough on any team. Obviously, you'd be down 7-0, but it's a high-scoring game, the high-scoring team in the league. Any chance at all? Are you guys looking forward to that 12-minute period, or are you looking forward to the second half?
Well, looking forward to the second half for sure, to gain some momentum, see what happens. You know, down by 7, it's going to be tough to come all the way back for sure, but, you know, we definitely have the firepower in here, and we're going to see what happens. Keep working.
Well, it's a tough hill to climb. Down by 7 goals after one half. Craig, back up to you.
All right, Jim, tough situation indeed for the Minnesota Arctic Blast here. The highest scoring in the league, team in the league, giving up 3 shorthanded goals and really embarrassing first half. But 24 minutes to go in the highest scoring play of the RHI. Minnesota during the regular season averaged almost 6 goals and a half. They're down 7-0 at the half, the first time all year they have been held scoreless in a half. In fact, you can't see that about many teams in the RHI. Shots on goal, big edge Buffalo, scoring chances. Hey, look at 14 good chances for Minnesota, with Tusi had to make some stops. The faceoffs were even, the power plays, a goal for Buffalo. But the big stat was 3 shorthanded goals for the men in the black and purple, who need to win twice tonight. The regular game here and then the 12-minute mini game, which will follow if the Stampede force it with the victory. You notice the wheels for the sport court surface as they adjust, sometimes change at the half to a new set. What a first half, though, for Buffalo. But really, with 24 minutes to go, it is not an overstatement at all to say that this game is certainly not over. Beccarelli with 3 points. And the first half, 2 short-handed goals. Socio, 2 points. Minnesota 0 for 4 on the power play. And the Blast shut out for the first time in the first half this year. But even more than their poor offense, their sloppy defense is the reason they're down by 7. Beccarelli comes in, looks for the hat, quick shot, and Pine makes the stop. There's Reed Larson, the veteran NHLer. And Beccarelli, the one smiling. Won't be many in the white uniform smiling here. Reed Larson, a Minnesota native. 3-time NHL All-Star, a 9-year career with the Red Wings, Boston, Edmonton, the Islanders, Minnesota, and Buffalo. Played over in Italy for a few years, including last year. And a quick whistle with 11:46 to go. Reed, University of Minnesota product. He was a heck of an NHL player, Jim. There's Denny Marouk, who has got to be wondering what's going on here. But really, if you think about it, Minnesota had a tough game against Atlanta. And the road in the playoffs has not been quite as smooth as the road in the regular season for the Arctic Blast. And Ringer coming in across the surface. Jim Howe goes for it. Now it's played around by Noel Ron. And he's shuffled out by Socio. Gave it away. Socio stealing, shooting wide. Oh, that would have been a killer.
There's an example, Craig, right there. The last man back has to be safe with that first outlet pass. You have to be absolutely sure. Again, Minnesota gives it away.
Minnesota's a younger team. Many just past the college age. Buffalo, a lot of experience. 8 players playing in the ECHL, 6 of them with Chris McSorley at Toledo last year, where they won the Riley Cup for their second straight year. And that helped Chris move on with his success to the International Hockey League, coach Las Vegas this year. Jim Howe scores! Jim Howe! Oh, how about that one? Good slap shot. And it looked like Peduzzi went right over it. And it's 7-1.
The puck was right along the floor. Jim Howe picked the spot perfectly. Howe on the angle. Will shoot the puck to the far side. Now keeps it right on the floor. It actually dings in off the post, so it's the placement of that shot. Looks like an innocent play. Watch the goalie. Bertuzzi, just as he's sliding his feet over, he's slumping, shuffling across. A shooter knows that. You don't necessarily look at the feet, but the shooter senses when the goaltender is ready to shuffle across, and Howe knew it, at the right time he pulled the trigger.
10:45 remaining, third quarter. Giveaway again. Cerrone in front, throws it to Bergeron, backhander. Oh, it may have hit the leg of Olin. Olin may have saved the day in front. Leyland lost control. They wave off the offside. Leyland now. That should have been offside. Late penalty of coming, though, on Buffalo. And Minnesota will work it back and regroup. Here's John Young. Dumps it back to Tim Hannes. Hannes throws it back. Minnesota taking their time. Now it's touched by Cerrone. No whistle yet. Young throws it in front. Leyland scores! Oh, they knew what they were doing. They set up Leyland in front, 7-2. Two goals in less than a minute.
And that's a situation you really don't get to practice that often with a goaltender pulled. But you're right, Craig. Minnesota knew exactly what they were doing. Set it up, take the time. Down off the low post is Leyland. One step, one quick step by Leyland. Very important there. He was not afraid to come to the front. Watch this move. There it is. And it was so quick. It caught the goaltender, Vitusi. Vitusi could not move quickly enough. And all it is the quick footwork. Denny Marouk told his team in the first half to get the feet moving. Leyland did it right there, got himself a good chance. Second goal for Minnesota.
This is the kind of start to the third quarter that Chris McSorley did not want. I mean, if there's anything you don't want to do, it's give Minnesota early momentum.
And both teams, it's difficult. Is Minnesota looking at the 12-minute minigame? Does Buffalo think they have it? So they're going to look to that third situation where they're going to try and decide the series. Minnesota scores a lot of goals. It's weird to say, but even down 7 goals after one half, still they're in the game.
Scoring goals for Minnesota is like going to the gas tank and filling up again, and that could be dangerous. Quick shot off the stick of Major. And of course, Buffalo's best attack here would be to attack and to keep the pressure on Bill Pye. Net knocked off the line. We get the whistle, 9:16 to go in the third quarter, and Minnesota is making a game out of it and then some. Early here in the third quarter, Buffalo has the lead, but now it's chopped down to 5 with 9:16 to go in the third. Third quarter, 9:16 to go, and during the intermission they were showing the fans a clip from the movie Animal House when John Belushi was rivaling up the gang and they ran out of the house, and they're hoping the team can do the same thing here. If anybody can, it's this team right here. Quick shot stopped off the stick of Jim Howe again. Now Randy Scarter circling around. Look at him regroup. He'll take it all the way back to his own zone. Sloppy pass, though. And it's grabbed by Rob Antringa, one of the few defensive-minded players on the team. He scored against Buffalo during the regular season, but had just a handful of goals, 4 in 21 games.
Something we haven't seen.
Oh, good save by Vitusi on the Antringa shot. Jim Howe now behind the net, has it in his skates, dumps it out, and Minnesota has indeed picked it up. But a 2-on-1 chance for Buffalo. Beccarelli coming down. Beccarelli in the backhand. Dumps it across the crease. And Buffalo could not get to it. And Randy Scarter dumps it in.
Craig, I was saying, something we haven't seen at all, I think, this season. But Buffalo right now, what they're doing is 4 men, they're not forechecking. They're lining up right across the center line and waiting for Minnesota to come to them. That's the first time this season I think I've seen a defensive shell, a 5-goal lead, and Buffalo thinking defense only.
Randy Scarter talked about it before the game, how disciplined Buffalo is, and it can almost get to a frustrating level for an offensive club, how they keep the players back. It's just the opposite of Minnesota's high-flying attack. In front, a shuffle attempt by Cerrone. Stopped by Pye, who hangs on. And it really was to the demise of Minnesota in the first half. Their gambling offensive style left a lot of holes.
I think if anything in the second half that Minnesota is going to try and do is raise the level. Well, maybe this guy wants to get on the floor. I don't think he likes what he's seeing. But what Minnesota has to do is try and pick up the confidence.
Each time you get it, walk right in. Let him haul you down. You had to walk right in on your forehand.
Denny Marouk's
been, he was already down.
I think he's been yelling. You can tell by the voice they're a little raspy. But Minnesota in the dressing room, if anything,
come on.
I don't think
come on,
frustration.
Blue line, that's what it was. Come on.
I don't think frustration was it, Craig. I think it was more the team was down. Their confidence is shot. Maybe they'll try to build that up before they go into what we expect to be a 12-minute minigame.
In an era where athletes are often rewarded for 4 seasons, that is not the case in the RHI. We'll develop that point in a moment. Jay Moore's shot is stopped. Morivo throws it. Cerrone now will clear it down. And this may go the length for an illegal clear. Kind of slows up. Well, they whistled it very early. And maybe a penalty, actually. Maybe a penalty on the Arctic Blast, I believe.
There's Rick Corbo going off. He's holding his chin. I think a power play coming up for Buffalo. The scoring in the playoffs. Victor Gervais of Anaheim leads everyone with 11. Hansen, Beccarelli, Wilcox, and Buchanan with 10 each. Obviously, that is coming in. Beccarelli with 2 goals tonight to get up to 10. The scores are known on Minnesota, and Hansen did it with 4 last night. That man had 5 in game 1 of this series. 2 shorthanded goals already tonight. He gets an assist. He's doing it all. And now Buffalo gets another chance to go on the power play. There's Jay Moore in the penalty box. The captain, I think it was high sticking. Corvo went off with a little bit of a cut. So Buffalo, they've allowed 2 straight goals. They have a chance here on the power play just to settle things down a little bit.
Minnesota lucky. It's only a 2-minute penalty. That cut could create a 5-minute major, which creates not only a 5-minute, but a penalty shot, which is the last thing that Minnesota wants to have happen here against them. Stampede coming in on the power play. So far, they are 1-for-1. Quick shot for the point. Score! Beccarelli's got a hat trick. And it did not take long. 28 seconds into that power play chance. It's 8-2 Buffalo.
Specialty teams all the way for Mr. Beccarelli. 2 shorthanded, 1 on the power play. Very simple on this one. He's at the top of the box. And he just lets it go. I think the deception here by Beccarelli, no backswing. Watch this. He doesn't take it back past parallel, so he doesn't waste any time on the release. Look at the release here. Comes back just above parallel. It kind of shoots off his wrong foot there. You saw it. So Bill Pye, the goaltender, he doesn't know that shot's coming. That looked more like the setup for a fake shot pass, but Beccarelli carried through with a shot. His 11th goal in the playoffs to go into the tie for the lead with Victor Gervais of Anaheim in the playoffs. Not too bad, 8-2 Buffalo.
A little technical here, Jimmy. When you say the wrong foot, it's the left foot, but sometimes you can still get a pretty good shot off there.
That's right, you're shifting your weight, and I think that's what deceives the goaltender. At times when you're leaning into it, that's what a goaltender expects. That time Beccarelli was kind of leaning away from the shot, and the surprise fooled the goaltender.
Normally on a shot, you follow through from your back foot to the front foot, and as Jim was talking about, Beccarelli stayed in that back foot. Flashing penalty, another one upcoming against Minnesota. They get the whistle before the shot.
And maybe a high stick, obviously. Hicks holding his face. And he's looking, oh, he's cut. So that could be a major penalty, Craig. You just discussed that situation.
That has to be major.
We'll see what happens here. The player is automatically out of the game if he gets a major penalty. Hicks still down on the floor.
Alex Hicks, the captain of the team, on the surface getting attended to with 6:09 to go. In the third quarter, Buffalo on the power play leading by 6. We're back at the Target Center. Buffalo leading 8-2. Still waiting for the official call from the referees. We'll take a look at it, though. Obviously, Hicks was cut, probably by a high stick.
Oh, yes. Whoa. Number 7. Ooh. John Hansen was getting back on the back check. We'll get a good look at it here. Right across, two-hander. Well, looked like it hit. Yeah, it's the stick of number 7. He's the right-hander reaching across. And the blade part, the pointy part, went up. Almost glanced off the arms maybe on the slash, but it did get high enough. John Hansen, known for his scoring, he's still talking it over with the officials. He's standing near the penalty box area. If it's inadvertent, sometimes they can give a 4-minute double minor for high sticking. But Craig, in that situation with Hicks being the puck carrier, well, he's going to the box, so that means he's not kicked out of the game. I'd have to
Daniel,
say...
let's go.
They did. 4 minutes.
They gave him that 4 minutes, but Craig, usually that's when you're not looking and one guy's falling, the accidental inadvertent. That one was a two-hander. From once you start from that and you lose control of your stick, I think you got to give the major. You've got to do it when you're trying to stop another player. Inadvertent, yes, he may not have tried to slash high,
yeah,
but still that two-handed slash motion, from that point on, you have to live with your actions. Well, he'll live right here with a double minor, and Hicks, he goes right back on the floor.
Yeah, it looked like he was kind of reaching in, Jim. I don't know. That's a tough call there. Usually when you draw blood, though, you're going to get the major penalty because of that.
It's an easy call for me. It's an easy call.
Regardless
no
of the inadvertency or not.
There's no doubt that that play was not inadvertent to make contact with the Buffalo player. Once the stick gets high after that point, there's no doubt that should be a major penalty. You're in the playoffs. You're in the semifinals of the league. The officials try to cut back a little bit. They didn't give the major.
Hicks is down low for Buffalo. I disagree 100%. No, not a little bit with you, though. Hicks is in the corner. And Moore dumps it down. I just thought that he kind of reached in. Maybe it slid up. But the referees are going to go along with that, give him a double minor because of the blood. A break, though, for Minnesota because at worst, they'll give up two power play goals. With a major, the guy does not come out of the box. Plus, you get the penalty shot. Plus, the guy could be kicked out of the game. Jay Neal is at the left point. Vecchiarelli looks for his fourth. Slap shot wide. Again off balance. Chris Bergeron, a two-point game. Vecchiarelli picks one timing. Blocker save. And a nice play by Leland to throw it to the corner. Hicks now, the rolling puck back to Jay Neal. Check that. It's Corvo now who stepped on. Corvo plaster wide of the net.
Greg, if there's one difference here between the power plays, Buffalo is much more urgent on the power play. They want the goals. When Minnesota gets a power play, they're a little tentative. They're not looking to get to the scoring area. But Buffalo is jumping on the loose pucks.
Jay Moore tries to make a nifty move. Minnesota normally a little crisper on the power play. Tonight they have been tentative. They're passing not as crisp. They're not getting those one-timers across the surface. Hicks scores! Alex Hicks snuck it by the goaltender. A wrist shot, perhaps screened, and it's 9-2 Buffalo.
Alex Hicks, good use of the defenseman there, using the defenseman as a screen. Once again, it's a situation where Hicks leans away and shoots back against the flow. Looks like Minnesota gets caught in a change. Yeah, you can see at the top of the screen. We'll take a look to see how many Buffalo players. Oh, just that little lean on the shot by Hicks. Number 9 was back, Corey Leland for Minnesota, but Hicks used him as a screen. He shot between his legs, so the puck is all of a sudden coming out from the feet of the defender, and Hicks puts one by. 4:31 remaining here in the third, Buffalo 9, Minnesota 2. There's still 2 minutes now remaining on the penalty against John Hansen, so Buffalo still on the power play.
Hicks will be following Coach Chris McSorley to Las Vegas. He signed a 2-year deal with the Thunder of the IHL, a level below the NHL. A big scoring defenseman. He's the all-time leader among D's in NCAA Division III, where he led Wisconsin-Eau Claire. He won the Riley Cup with Toledo as well. Socio shot! He was raising his stick, but that's becoming a natural instinct now for Buffalo, shooting and then raising their stick.
Talk about confidence. And the crowd is out of it now. You can't hear anyone from Minnesota really trying to get their team going. Socio leans into it. He gets the time to really wind up. The transfer of weight was apparent there, but Bill Pye had no traffic in front that time. The goaltender had a chance to see it. He really didn't cover up on the rebound, but the referee lost sight of the puck when he blew the whistle.
A lot of people out there, Jim, watching tonight, play in roller hockey leagues. Is there a better way to shoot the puck?
Yeah, behind the goalie. That's where you shoot it.
Great, great insight. Thank you. Young coming in. Nice move. Backhander wide of the net. Normally, though, you would get with the follow-through a little more of your stick and obviously a faster shot.
And I think people talk in roller hockey, they try to pick the puck off the floor a little more. In ice hockey, sometimes you can almost take a divot. The shooters look to shoot behind the puck. I think it changes here on the floor.
League sprouting up across the country. It really is amazing. One of the fastest growing sports is roller hockey. Just about anywhere you go now, you see kids with the sticks and the wheels outside. You may do the same in your neck of the woods. Jim Fox normally before the game is outside trying a new move. Socio on the corner, backhands it in. 42 seconds to go. That first penalty expires with the goal. We were talking about if they had the 5-minute major, that would not be the case. LeMay shoots, trying to pick a spot. It stopped. Minnesota can't clear it though. LeMay now coming down, man in front, gets it to him, shot, save in front, rebound stop again, another chance, Cerrone. And it was blocked by the Dean. Young tackled Cerrone. Young still on Cerrone.
Three shots in a row. Buffalo moving the penalty killers around for Minnesota. Minnesota, usually the penalty killers are stationary, tight triangle. They're running all over the place and Buffalo getting their chances.
Jay Neal toward the net wide. Don't go anywhere. Buffalo does win this game. A 12-minute mini game will decide. Another chance in front. Same rebound. And it's knocked along the line, but not in. Larry Olin takes it out. And the Arctic West stayed up. Here's John Hansen coming down shooting. Delayed penalty. Rebound wide. A penalty coming up on Buffalo. Minnesota gets the extra attacker on. And now Buffalo touches up. Alex Hicks will be going off. 2 minutes, 11 seconds remaining in what has been a nightmarish evening for Dennis Marouk and company.
And it's Marouk's job now to get his team back up. Not necessarily concern himself with winning this second half and getting back into the game. He's just got to get the confidence level up. You can tell the confidence of Bill Potter, goaltender.
Hey, keep doing that. Keep taking them. That's it. All right? That's it.
Try to stay positive as a coach. I think when he's looking towards that 12-minute minigame. But every time Bill Pye makes two or three saves in a row, he drops his head a little bit. He looks a little down, a little frustrated. Some way, Minnesota has to try and get it back going the other way. Even if they don't win this game, they have to look forward to the 12 minutes.
Things have not really gone well for Minnesota. Nice glove stop by Pye in the playoffs. After winning 14-4 for Atlanta, we did the game. They had to go to a shootout to beat the 500 Ants. I don't mean they're 500 players, they were 500 deep. As Hansen works it around. Then they played Pittsburgh. They lost the opener in Pittsburgh 8-6 against the talented Phantoms team. They came back in game two. They were down 4-2 early, had to scramble back to win 14-11. And then they won the minigame last Friday night, 4-1 over Pittsburgh. So they did what Buffalo wants to do, and that's when two games, put games in quotes, in one night. Minute 25 to go. And then they had the struggle last night again. So the competition obviously has gotten better, but clearly Minnesota has not distanced themselves from the tough competition here in the playoffs.
John Beccarelli controlling here on the penalty kill. You can see that now he's a threat. He's a weapon, Beccarelli is, because as soon as he picks up the puck, even though his team is shorthanded, Minnesota going back and thinks defense because they are afraid of what Beccarelli can do. He's already has two shorthanded goals.
Olin throwing it in front of the backhand. And they got very cute. Leyland on the backhand did not beat the goaltender. With 52 seconds to go here in the third quarter of play. Mentioning that Pittsburgh-Minnesota series was Vic Brawl initiated by Brian Trotche.
Trotche trying to get Minnesota off their game with a little intimidation. Nick Petrucci very calm and cool in the Buffalo goal. He went down to his knees there. Spotted the play of Leyland, made it look easy. Chris McSorley will not back off an inch. He was in the dressing room at halftime. His team was up by 7. It appeared like they were down a couple of goals. He was rallying the troops. Now they have it back in control again. They still have that 7-goal lead.
Coaches are keeping our man Jeff in the audio booth tonight with a very quick trigger. A live game, and Mike's on both of the coaches. Score! Good shot, Moore. Jay Moore, a power play goal. And it's now 9-3 Buffalo.
And I've got to think right now, Dennis Marouk, the head coach of Minnesota, is going to be telling his players, hey, did you see that last power play goal? Keep it simple. Shoot the puck. Don't look for everything pretty all the time down for the wraparounds down there close. One simple pass. Olam, Moore, and he's going to fire it. If it doesn't go in, he wants a rebound. He wants a deflection. But one thing to keep in mind, get the shot on goal. Good shot here by Moore. A little bit of a screen, and it goes off the far post. That's the third goal for Minnesota. They need to score more than that. 40.2 seconds remaining here in the third quarter. Buffalo leads 9-3.
Becoming a favorite spot. It's interesting, earlier in the game, Dennis Marouk was saying that the Blast should shoot high on Bertuzzi. They beat him down low here a couple of times with some crafty shots from that left wing. 27 seconds remaining in the third quarter.
Greg, it's usually funny listening to coaches talking about where to shoot. There's one simple rule. The goaltender's down, you shoot it up. The goaltender's protecting the high, you shoot it low. Nothing confusing. You just do what the goaltender doesn't give you.
You're a goal scorer, though, and you make it sound so easy.
You really can't plant it. I think you can plant the seed of a style of a goaltender. But once you get the puck, you got to release it as quick as you can.
Well, one thing you can plant, the end of the third quarter. And there it is. And the other thing you can plant on is that Jim Fox will be heading down to the benches for the fourth quarter of play. Well, did the Stampede have enough? Still going to take 12 minutes to send this one to a mini game, but it's looking good after three. Buffalo stampeding over Minnesota by 6. You look at the Minnesota bench, Randy Scarta looking in, and the Arctic Blast head coach Dennis Marouk. And if Minnesota cannot at least tie it up and send this game to a shootout. We'll have a 12-minute mini game for you live tonight after a short intermission to decide the series and send one of these teams to the finals. We talked about some sports rewarding players with contracts before the year. In fact, most sports. In this sport, the money is heavily weighted toward the playoffs if you keep winning. The team that wins it all earns about an extra $8,000, $8,000 to $9,000 in the playoffs. Like one of the Stampede players, John Blessman, I believe, was hurt on that play. Tonight alone, the difference is about $2,000 to the team that wins and the team that loses per player. And these are minor league players without ritzy contracts. And that is a significant change. Buffalo leading after three. The shots on goal, 46 through three quarters for Buffalo. An edge in scoring chances. The faceoffs are even. The power plays, Buffalo with three power play goals. Minnesota, the best power play in the league. Just one for five tonight, 20%. They were 65% during the regular season. It has not been quite as effective in the playoffs. As you would expect, though, with the better competition. Quick shot, save, Bertuzzi. In front, spin around shot, had a save, backhand, save again, Bertuzzi. He made three. And Buffalo will dump it down. We may see this a few times in the second half of play. Wheeled around by Olim. Now steered toward the net. Briefly by Hendry for Buffalo. And Minnesota works it out. 11 minutes to go in regulation of game two. David shoots across the surface. Quick shot by Hansen wide of the net. Check thrown in the corner by Bergeron for Buffalo. And they come out two on one. LeMay throwing it toward the net. Hendry was going toward the net, but never got the puck. You wonder from a coaching standpoint, Jim, how difficult it might be now for Buffalo to, from a coaching standpoint, you don't want to lay down. At the same time, you don't want to take any silly chances.
Exactly right, Craig. You don't want to lay down and get the momentum away from your team going in to that 12-minute mini game. You want to keep their spirits high. You don't want to take the back steps. Now we see a penalty against Buffalo, so the game certainly is not getting away from them by any means. Looked like just a penalty away from the play. Minnesota trying to get this play going offensively, and well, just taken down. Knocked off the puck. Looked like pretty good defensive position, but Minnesota goes on the power play.
Jason Cerrone goes to the box for 2 minutes. Minnesota 1-for-5 on the power play, and again have given up three shorthanded goals. One in the first quarter, and two quick ones, both by Beccarelli in the second quarter. Buffalo went up 7-0 at the half. Minnesota outscored Buffalo 3-2 in the third. Jim, I would think, if nothing else, and again, they're not out of the game by any means yet, but they want to get their offense clicking on the power play here.
That's right. Try the simple plays. Go to the set plays. Just execute.
Olin, quick one-timer. Hit the post. They had him beat that time. That was classic Minnesota hockey right there on the power play as Moore was set up for the one-timer that the goaltender had no chance at. Bertuzzi stops young that time.
Craig, those shots from the angles may not be going in, but you use those shots to open things up. Something down low will open up if you keep shooting from the top.
Yes, and you can also set up the guy up top if you have to watch the guys in the wings. Going toward the net, wraparound attempt by Leland was wide. Now Moore takes it, cross surface, one-timer, hit the side of the net. John Young. There's Young again. Block. Moore could not tee it up. Olim. Shot stopped by Bertuzzi with 9:25 to go here in the fourth quarter. 57 seconds on the penalty. One thing Buffalo does not want to see in this game or if they get to the minigame would be a shootout where they are 2-5 now this year. Good look at Chris McSorley, the brother of Los Angeles King Marty McSorley. GM coach, also a part owner of Buffalo, one of 10 kids. And he moved over from Anaheim to take the ownership coaching role here in Buffalo after leading the Bullfrogs to the title last year. Would it be interesting if his team can move on and he would take on Anaheim for the championship? Yeah. Goal off the stick in front! And it got by Matusi. Annis may have gotten a stick in the hands and shot. And it's now 9-4 with plenty of time to go. 9:03 remaining.
Doesn't appear like Minnesota's really setting up camp in front, but there's timing. As the shot is going to come through, that's when the setup goes. There's Hansen through, there's the other setup. So now they have two men low. It looks like it deflected off of the Buffalo defender trying to block the shot. Well, there it is, right off the left leg of Dave Shute, number 20. It goes off the left leg. Watch the goaltender, he flinches one way, just sneaks in the short side on the deflection. Minnesota on the board with another power play goal.
Oh, great look at it there. He was going to his left, as you said, Jim. And the puck skittered by to the right off the defenseman's leg. So Hansen will get the goal. He now has 11 in the playoffs. We get a whistle and another power play opportunity coming up here. It's going to be a slashing penalty, and it will be on Minnesota. So the Arctic Blast pull within 5, but now they'll have to defend a Buffalo power play when we come back to the Target Center.
We're again with Chris McSorley down on the Buffalo bench. Chris, any special strategy here? You're coming down to the end of the game, 5-goal lead?
Well, it's nice to have a 5-goal cushion against a team as strong as Minnesota, but we're going to need every goal we have right now. Our guys are getting a little winded right now, and support right now from capitalizing this power play. We get this power play goal, and I think you're going to see Minnesota maybe pack up and wait for the minigame.
What an unusual, unique situation. There is that 12-minute minigame coming. Does that change how you look upon the game as a coach?
I think Dr. Kevorkian, he must have a position here with RHI, because it's definitely something that's not for the faint of heart, and I'm not real excited all about it, but then again, we're the team that lost the first game. We have to look forward to trying to get through this game and look forward to the second game.
Well, it's a mental thing. You have to look forward, but you can't look too far ahead. Buffalo, no doubt, though, they're in control throughout this entire game. The confidence level of Minnesota is way down, and Buffalo feels real good.
Jim, if nothing else, and again, we keep reiterating with 8 minutes to go, there's still plenty of time. They're only down by 5, highest scoring team in the league. But you would think that if they can get something going, even get 2 or 3 back and head into that mini game, Minnesota, I'm speaking of, with some momentum, that could help them out in that final 12 minutes to decide the series if Buffalo can win this one.
Craig, what that does is allow them something positive to talk about in the intermission before the 12-minute minigame. They can go back in there, we'll be in the dressing rooms, and we'll talk to them, we'll see if they can get something positive here. It's something they can talk about that is not negative. And I think that would be important going into that minigame.
Beccarelli throws it over to Neal, back to Beccarelli, score! What a setup by Beccarelli and Jay Neal. And John Beccarelli, who had 5 goals in game 1, has 4 goals in game 2.
Whoa! Shoot the puck when it's going in. And Beccarelli, he's been eager and hungry for the puck all night, chasing it down. This is what Buffalo likes to do. It's a box, and there's the shooter. Again, there's no real backswing by Beccarelli. He doesn't waste any motion on the backswing. He gets everything going forward, and he really slaps it. He uses a very long stick. When you have that long stick, you have a big arc, and that means a harder shot. He showed it to us there. 10th goal on the night for Buffalo.
Long hair and long stick for John Beccarelli, who turned 30 years old on July the 4th out of Toronto, Ontario. Chris McSorley, in fact, used to check Beccarelli in the IHL. Shot scored in the way! Rob Andringa coming in for Minnesota, and the Arctic Blast are back within 5.
Now there's something they can talk about. Andringa not known for jumping in on the offense. He usually stays at home. But when the opportunity presents itself, join the offense. And this time he's way out in front of the play. So he keeps going. It's a smart play. And he just uses his smarts. The quick release here I think is important too. Goaltender Matusi tries to slide across, but it's a quicker release. Another look at it on a 2-on-1. When Matusi decided to go for that two-pad slide, he was well out of his net, but a good pinpoint shot by the defenseman. 10-5 Buffalo.
And Fringa scored the tying goal in the regular season against Buffalo to send the game to overtime, which Minnesota won in that shootout, 5-4. Minnesota, in case you're just joining us, won game 1 last night in Buffalo at the auditorium, 8-7 in a shootout. So Buffalo has to win this regulation game and then the 12-minute mini game, which will follow. In front of the net, some pushing and shoving. Jim Howe A delayed penalty upcoming on Buffalo. Al was looking for a penalty. Socia cannot believe that it's going to be on him.
Socia took a couple of shots to the chin, but I think he was the man who instigated the situation. Buffalo is known for being so strong in front of their own goal. That's where Socia was. And both players were exchanging grins after the play. But during the play, there was a couple of punches thrown. Socia was the only man to go to the box. Again, Minnesota's just looking for little things to get him going. They have another power play.
He deserved it.
7 minutes, 21 seconds, regulation. And Minnesota, 2-for-6 in the power play tonight, will get their seventh chance. Certainly the most dangerous weapon so far has been Beccarelli, power player shorthanded. Beccarelli has 2 power play goals and 2 shorthanded goals. The way to stop Beccarelli is to keep an even stretch. He's been tough in the specialty teams department, hasn't he? Minnesota comes in, 1:45 to go in the penalty. Scotter trying to set it up. Number 14 is Tim Hannes. He's had some outstanding efforts in shootouts. He's won both of the shootouts with decisive goals in the playoffs. They beat Atlanta in the first round in the shootout. And then last night at Buffalo, Hannes had the decisive shootout goal. Randy Scarta through Hansen's legs. 6:37 to go. Players are on the sport court surface. 26,000 plastic tiles. Hansen shooting it, and it's rough stop there by Nick Petusic. And he hangs on. Nick with the best goals against average in the playoffs at 6.21 coming in. Game rewind, Beccarelli with 5 points. Buffalo, great in the specialty teams. 7 total goals there. Minnesota, just 33% of the power play tonight. And again, if the Stampede win, that'll force a 12-minute minigame, which, by the way, if it's tied at the end of 12 minutes, we'll have a shootout to decide the Eastern Conference winner and see which team moves on to play Anaheim and Portland, the winner of that Western Series. Here's Olin at the point, 54 seconds of the penalty to Buffalo. Olin steered in front, Leyland shot, stopped, and dumped down by John Blessman.
Greg, on this penalty kill, Buffalo is electing not to take Corey Leyland in front. They're allowing him to stand in front. That last little pass got through, but he's down a little too close, not much room to work.
Olin hacked from behind by Beccarelli. Hits the skate of LeMay, 5:50 in regulation, one-timer. Young, what a blast, it almost knocked Petusi into the net, but he hangs on. John Young, the leading scorer in the regular season with 79 points in the RHI, won that scoring title with a 6-point effort in the final game against New England.
We'll get a chance to see Young kind of skating back, and then he stops, plants, and fires, and it did knock over Petusi. The goaltender getting back squared to the shooter, that's very important. We haven't talked much about this guy, especially in the first half, because his team was busy scoring goals. But he's been very solid in goal, plays the shooter very well. We saw in that last play, very comfortable.
Jim, no goal for Young, but does he feel a little bit better that he knocked the goaltender over as a kind of a macho shooter?
I think anything that goes positive for Minnesota right now, they're going to take, and he may look at it like that.
We couldn't knock the puck in, but we almost knocked the goalie over the line. 5:30 to go. Larson with a quick shot. Petusi, by the way, started as a forward in his hockey career. Kid. Got those fine of that. Backhanded by Ron. Then we get the whistle as one of the Buffalo players was knocked down. But Jay Neal. Jay Neal was knocked, possibly hit up in the face again by an Eric Stick. For the puck. Well, the CFL returns for more excitement on ESPN2 Friday at 7:30 when the Ottawa Rough Riders take on the Saskatchewan Rough Riders. No, it's not an inter-squad game. It's CFL, offensive action at its best. Don't look away because you'll miss something for sure. The Canadian Football League only on the news. Of course, Ottawa Rough Riders, that's 2 words, and Saskatchewan is only 1 word. Great. 5:18 remaining. In regulation, Buffalo leads 10-5.
Greg, you see Jay Neal, he's going off right now. I'm down on the bench here with Larry Olam. Larry, tell me the situation. You've been behind all game. Are you looking forward to that 12-minute mini game, and can you change things to make it go your way?
I sure think so. It was a really disappointing start, but we got to forget about that. And we came to play in the second half and try to win the game. And if we don't win the game, let's try to get momentum built up for the last 12 minutes. And no matter what the score is after this game, we got 12 more minutes. So we're going to, you know, we still feel confident. And 12 minutes, anything can happen.
I mentioned in the first intermission, at halftime, the situation was your team didn't seem frustrated, but it sure did seem down. Is that what you're talking about? Getting the momentum going back so you can get on an up?
Exactly. You know, I think the guys know that it wasn't over, so we're not real frustrated, but we're really disappointed in ourselves. And there's no excuses at all. We just didn't come ready to play, and we got to get ready for that. You know, if we can't come back here, we got to get ready for those 12 minutes.
Hey, good luck.
Minnesota with a big advantage in the fourth quarter with shots on goal, but you kind of expect that with Buffalo playing a little bit of a defensive style here. Giving up some exterior shots, still not allowing, if they can, the real good scoring chances. Buffalo led 7-0 at the half. They went out to an explosive start. Really a sloppy Minnesota effort as well. Three shorthanded goals for Buffalo. And it was a combination of Buffalo playing well and Minnesota playing horrible. Hicks coming in. He's got a couple shoots. That one goes in and caught the corner. And Hicks for Buffalo has got the hat trick himself, his sixth goal of the playoffs, and it's now 11-5.
Hicks shooting against the flow, get the goaltender moving one way, then shoot the other. And if anyone does seem down, I think, for Minnesota, it may be the all-star goaltender, Bill Pye. He's not used to this many goals. And look at him shuffle. The goaltender cannot move on rollers as well as he can shuffle on ice. But it's a perfect example. Again, the shooter kind of senses, nice quick release. It didn't look like at all that Hicks would have a chance to get a shot off. The puck was way out in front of him. It was in the feet of the defenseman, but he just propelled it towards the goaltender, and Billy Pye was moving across. Moving. Buffalo 11, Minnesota 5.
4 minutes, 23 seconds to go. Jim, I'm just wondering if at some point here, Minnesota's going to think about trying to save their legs for the minigame. Wade Larson skating out up to Jim Howe coming in. Good wrist shot. Oh, effective shot. And we're stopped by Bertuzzi, and he hangs on with 4 minutes and 9 seconds remaining in regulation. And Buffalo with a six-goal advantage. And looking toward the minigame, if they can hang on over the next 4:09. We're back to the Target Center in a moment. Buffalo, the story in game two.
I'm here with Dennis Marook, head coach of the Minnesota Arctic Blast. Dennis, obviously a tough night, but it's kind of like a savior, that 12-minute game that's coming up. Anything that a coach can do to pick his team back up, just turn it around 180 degrees?
Well, they got to be positive, stay together. You know, we've had a pretty good season so far, so, you know, why end it right now? So they're good players. They just got to stay positive and work together.
I know a couple of games back we were talking to you, especially on the power play. Keep it simple. Don't try to be fancy. It appeared to me that when you have been simple tonight on the power play, just the shots on goal, that's when they're going in.
Yeah, that's right. They're going in, but they're blocking a lot of shots too. So they're doing a good job defensively, blocking shots and killing. But, you know, you never know. Anything can happen.
Any new challenge for a coach going into that 12-minute mini game? You really don't see it in any other sport. Something you can prepare for or not?
No, it's not nothing you can prepare for. It's basically, you know, the players have played together most of the year. So they just got to say it's either we win, we lose, someone's got to win.
All right, back up to you, Craig.
All right, Jim, 11-5 Buffalo. We have a delay on the surface as they attend to the glass, I believe it is right there you're looking at. That gentleman has a tough job of holding up one of these stanchions. Jim, I wonder if you can get the feeling from one of the players on the financial aspect of this series, as you see David McLean from the league office adding his 2 cents there. But the money difference is at least $2,000 to the winner of this team. It's $4,000 to $2,000. What kind of factor is that for the players, Jim?
Down here with Alex Hicks. Alex, an outstanding game by the entire team, but obviously yourself, I think, with 3 goals. What do you think the difference has been so far tonight?
Well, I think we just came out and played really good defensively. That might sound kind of stupid since we scored 11 goals, but we just capitalized on all their mistakes. And we knew they were going to try to score a lot of goals. We knew if we just sat back, we're going to get our chances, and luckily the puck was going in.
Obviously, the big lip you got going right there, a little cut under the nose. High stick, it looked like to me perhaps a major penalty. He took a pretty good two-hander. What's your input? You're the guy who took that slash.
Well, I told the guy in the penalty box when I took a penalty after that, I said if I would have done something like that, I would have got life. But, you know, it's just the way it goes. I thought it should have been five. You know, the guy deliberately slashed me right in the face, but you got to suck it up a little bit. And we were fortunate to score two power play goals on that, and I'll take the two power play goals.
Everyone talks about discipline, especially in the playoffs, when it comes to taking those types of penalties. Your team is known. You led the league in penalty minutes. How difficult is it come playoff time to all of a sudden say, hey, we can't retaliate. Keep your mind on the game.
Well, that's probably the easiest part, doing that, because we all know that you know, we're old enough to realize that we've got to suck it up a little bit. But I think the hardest part is battling the refs, because they're used to calling us penalties all year. And, you know, some of the other teams in the league that take a lot of penalties are probably going through the same thing right now, because they're used to you taking 10, 11, 12 minors, and they're going to call them on you. And as you've seen tonight, we've been shorthanded the whole game.
All right, let's get back at her.
All right, just about ready to go with 4 minutes and 9 seconds remaining here in the fourth quarter. Both teams may want to just get to that extra session. Looks like we have an extra off-ice official tonight with an unusual job of helping hold one of the stanchions in place. Some of the physical checks we have seen here tonight. Reed Larson goes after it, plays it into the corner. Shuffled aside by Noel Ron, number 12 for Minnesota. Cross surface, Corriveau delays around Larson, hooked by Larson, bothered. Shot steered aside by Pye, was knocked down. The goaltender hit hard by Chris Bergeron of Buffalo. 3.5 to go. Larson checked aside. Now in front, shot, score! No run! It's Minnesota within five with 3:23 to go.
Well, the second time tonight that Minnesota has taken advantage of the goaltender pulled on a delayed penalty, and they really do take their time. They get used to that extra man, just trying to control along the boards. Then the puck goes right to the middle. Good quick release. Noel Ron there, he just reached back and flicked the wrist. I don't know if there was a screen there or not. A lot of Minnesota players around the net if there's a rebound. So you take advantage of that extra man, you take all the time the other team gives you. And that's the sixth goal for Minnesota tonight. Once again, maybe one of the positive things they can talk about between the intermission when they're looking forward to that 12-minute minigame.
Well, 3:23 to go. I'll tell you, if they get a quick goal here, they might still be thinking about this one. They need a quick one, and they'll have some 3 minutes to operate. Now by four, 11-6 Buffalo, 3:10 to go. Randy Skarner plays it. Randy holds the Gopher record, most goals by a defenseman at the University of Minnesota at 19 in a short college year. Jay Moore's shot is stopped. Up in the air boards, thrown out. Breakaway chance, Socia has got Beccarelli ahead of him, going for number five. Beccarelli on the wrong foot, saved by Pye. Socio there for the rebound, and Young comes back to play it. 2 minutes, 40 seconds remaining in regulation. Corey Leland, number nine. Corey coming in. Got blocked by the defense. Dennis Farouk talked about the Buffalo D getting in the way of shots. Well, you saw it again right there. This one looks like it's headed to a minigame. 12 minutes to decide the season for these two teams. One will move on to the finals, and one will pack it in and look to the ice hockey season. Leyland comes in, Escarda worked it in front, he knocked the net over. And we get the whistle with 2:07 to go. Nick Petrucci wanted to play goaltender all along, started out as a forward. His dad said, play a year forward, improve your skating, and then you can go play goal. At the age of seven, he played goal, and he said he wanted to quit after the first day of practice because the equipment was too heavy. But eventually he got used to it, and has a fascination with goaltender men. He used to love the wild mask of former New York Ranger goalie Gilles Graton, who had a lion design and was one of the first goaltenders to really get the mask into some kind of wacky design. It was a ferocious lion kind of coming out and biting you, which had no relation to the a mascot or anything of the Rangers. Dumped down the minute 40 to go on a legal clear, and Petusi said that was one of his attractions to playing golf. Hey, Jim, I was talking about the financial aspect, and the players have been talking about it. There's a significant amount of money on the line here. Maybe you can get a response from one of the players on that.
Well, I'm sure they're interested in that. Obviously, you want to win. As an athlete, pride is always the main determining factor. But you're right, Craig. They play a very short season compared to the regular ice hockey season. But the money does add up here in the playoffs.
Well, not only that, though, it's weighted in this situation in the RHI. It's weighted heavily toward the playoffs. And the players know that. And success in the playoffs, the difference here tonight is over $2,000 between the winning and losing teams. Buffalo trying to clear it. Captain again, Olim in front, can't get to it. A minute and 15 to go. Now shoot at the point. Lost control, and he whacks it back into his own zone. And this one is headed to a minigame. We'll go to the locker rooms at the intermission. And listen in.
1 minute remaining in the fourth quarter. 1 minute.
Noel Ron skating up. What Minnesota has to realize here is the slate is completely wiped clean in 50 seconds. And psychologically, although they've been beaten here in game two, they've got to realize they are even up when the 12-minute minigame starts. Jim Howe flips it out. Noel Ron in his own zone. Out of St. Cloud State. Works as a sports agent for Brian Lawton's office, former NHLer here in Minneapolis. Left wing corner, Jim Howe throws the body. Jim playing in his second year of roller hockey, played in the World Roller Hockey League last year, and that league merged with the RHI this year as the league expanded from 12 to 24 teams around the country and up into Canada. Bergeron coming in, Bergeron through the crease, and that'll do it. So, task number one is accomplished by the Buffalo Stampede as they win game number two by an 11-6 final in game two. And Dennis Farouk will head off and get his team thinking confidently as you look at the Stampede going into the dressing room. And right now, they really have not done anything yet either, because if they don't win the 12-minute minigame, their season is over. But at least they have forced the decisive 12 minutes, and now they have a chance to go on to the championship series against the winner of Anaheim or Portland. Alex Hicks talking to the referees, obviously complaining about some kind of penalty or problem he has with the other team. Very rare to see the captain compliment the referee, saying nice job, good call, in this kind of a situation. Hicks had an outstanding first game. He scored 3 goals. His biggest thrill was winning the Riley Cup. He won 2 of them. Back-to-back championships for Chris McSorley at Toledo. One of them in double overtime. So the referees and the players head off. Everybody's a celeb here at the Target Center. But right now, Buffalo is 12 minutes away from moving on. We'll be back in a moment. Buffalo wins game two, 11-6. Don't go anywhere. The minigame is upcoming in just a few minutes right here on the Deuce. Right now the teams are in the respective locker rooms talking it over. We'll see what the Stampede have to say. Jim Fox is in the Buffalo locker room.
In the middle to the defenseman. Make sure wingers go in with a swing pattern. Avoid contact in the offensive zone. We go in the offensive zone, we chase the opponent down for some contact, I guarantee you. If they roll off, it's going to be a 4-on-3. You bet Minnesota with their offensive guns, they're going to activate all 4 guys. Let's go up there, penetrate, pick up the weak sides, leave the middle of the ice to the defenseman. We do that, guys, we're going to have ourselves a successful quarter. We've got a lot of money in the line, let's go.
Chris, I think you bring up a very good point there. It's one of those gray areas. You're a team that has to hit. At the same time, if Minnesota does roll off, they're going to come at you full speed.
Well, this is a team that if we go in the offensive zone and try to force this team, they're going to you're going to bet you're going to see four blast jerseys chasing towards our net. We got to go in there just like the start of the game. We went and picked up the weak sides, really slowed the game down, made it somewhat of an exciting sport, a very boring sport, but 11 goals, you can't deny us at this point.
Winning the game, now looking back, as easily as you did, does that change the preparation here going into this minigame?
Well, it's funny, but I don't see any guys loosening the skates, but it's all a brand new ball game right now. And Minnesota threw some penalties on our behalf. They gained a lot of momentum there at the end of the game, and you can bet this team's going to come out. They're going to play strict man-on-man, a lot of force action right at the start of the period, and they're going to try to get on that board first.
All right, thanks, Chris. I'm going to go around again and try and get some words here from some of the from the players here in the Stampede. John Hendry, John, one of the few, it's a unique